Very good.
All right, so here we are with another Have a Chat. And today I've got Jeff Mills. Jeff is a legendary head of department who has put his team through the Engage Maths course recently. Well, not everyone's quite finished. But I love engaging with the heads of department and workshopping a few things. So we haven't really talked, have we, Jeff, about how it all went. So I thought, let's just capture this and I'll anything that's not fit for the public, we'll delete.
Yep. So, that's fine.
So you... had you been looking at doing this for a while, the team approach with the Engage Maths course?
No, not at all. I think when we spoke after doing the, because I did a few courses years ago.
Yeah.
And then through that COVID period, we had a chat about screen recording, Camtasia.
Oh, that's right. Yes, yes.
Yeah, on the back of the flip classroom course that I did those years ago, you mentioned after we had a chat about ways to get a whole team to look at another way of doing things.
Right.
And, right up my alley in terms of where we want to go as a faculty. We've just recently finished.
Right. I've got a question. I don't really have anything scripted here, right? So this is literally a conversation. When I was a head of department, I found that the one thing I really wanted to do was have an influence on the teaching that went on. And that was the thing that never happened for me. And I always felt that, I mean, I got on well with my department, but teachers, and I've spoken to other heads and they tend to agree with me, most teachers want their heads of department to sort of help them navigate their way as a teacher, but don't try and tell me how to teach. Is that a sense? But there are some leaders who somehow have that mantle where people are like, yeah, give us some ideas. Which camp are you in? Do you find that you you get on well with the staff, but it's difficult to say, hey, look, here's an idea I'd like you to explore?
Yeah, I'd say when I first stepped into the position, I thought that change could happen very quickly. But I think what I learned was how to work with people that do think very differently to myself. So with the first 2 years was getting into their mindsets. And look, to be honest, I'm always looking to improve my teaching. So to build trust with my staff, it's about showing my vulnerabilities,
yes, exactly.
Being very open and honest about lessons that have not worked well for me or things that I've been able to do to improve and sort of just lead by example. I wouldn't say that I'm the sort of head that would, tell people this is how you need to do things. But when things go wrong, then a conversation might open up about, all right, well, how about we have a look at the lesson? Maybe there's some things that we could adjust. And typically when things come to my attention, it's around behavior management. So I've always believed that we create our disengaged students. So if you think about that most disengaged year 10 student who's just awful and, we slowly but surely have had some part to play in creating that student, whether it's through lessons that have been well thought out or well resourced or if you take shortcuts in the short term shortcuts, then we can carve that very disengaged, very disruptive student. And of course, kids come from different backgrounds and they bring their own things. But, there's some responsibility that I always share in that.
I could tell you some stories. But one of the things that I used to do, though, with those students that really get on your goat. And then you're frustrated because you're always on their case, and you think I've got to get off their case. But as soon as I walk in the room, they've done something wrong, and I'm back on their case again. And the best thing I found is to go and watch another an accomplished teacher working with a class with that same student, and just sit in the background, just watch. And it's not necessarily that there's not necessarily something tangible like a strategy or anything. That it just it's always been a, oh my gosh, wow, this is how this student can operate.
Yeah.
And it just opens the door. So previously, I think we often have a mindset, this kid is, we box them, right? They are the kid who always mucks up, in the first 5 seconds and blah, blah, blah. And when you realize, well, that's only in my in my lessons, things change.
Yeah, and you can, that reflective practice, absolutely.
Definitely. Did you find, because one of the things I say is that this course for a head of department or any sort of pedagogical leader can be really powerful at gaining some influence over their staff, like pedagogical influence, by becoming one of the team and not being that person that says, look, I'm really wanting you to explore X, Y, and Z, but because I'm the one that says that, or the course does. And so you're just one of the team, and then you can, by engineering some clever conversations, you can maybe bring stuff out of teachers. Did you find that that was a useful foundation to help you steer the ship, so to speak?
Yeah, absolutely. So we had meetings every week.
Right.
So we sat down as a group, and we had it initially in two different groups, but they came together in the end. And so we would just go like two modules at a time.
Yeah.
And the discussions were just around the content that you presented in your course. But a lot of the conversation was just reflecting on things that have and have not worked. And the conceptual approach certainly was not a term that I've used before. So it gave me some more vocabulary. A lot of what we've been trying to do this year outside of the course is focus on core skills over content. So I think a lot of teachers can get caught up in, if you look at the content statements in the syllabus and you've got to check them off, or even worse, if you're using a resource that dictates that for you, then you end up, quite confused with what it is you want to teach. In my mind, there's a very big difference between going into a lesson thinking about what you're teaching or thinking about what the kids are learning. They're two very So like this year with my year eight group, I've been very open and honest with my staff, like I mentioned before, about what has and hasn't worked, and then using the course as a foundation for discussion to try and promote change.
So
But
is
yeah, no, it's very worthwhile.
the question I wanted to ask is, was there a particular strategy or linked strategies that you found really opened up something in your teaching that was new, that like was like, okay, this actually makes sense. This is quite different. It doesn't look different, but it is quite different, and I'm getting much more engagement. I feel like this is a direction to head in.
Yeah, I enjoyed the fractional doings activities. I think without meaning to, I have kept them somewhat separate. When I'm doing fractions and decimals, I typically work with images that are in my mind. So this year, as a result of the course, I was sort of branching away from just like bars, like rectangles to circles. But then you can still have like your fractional doings activities where the kids are finding the roadblocks on the way through. So that roadblocking was the one of the take homes for me. I think previously in my teaching, it's been very hard to resist the temptation for answering questions for kids that they haven't asked yet. And I think that was the probably the most the powerful take home there was answering questions that the kids haven't yet asked. And if we're doing that, then
Which is the way most of us maths teachers teach, or teach traditionally, right? Because I'm the fountain of all knowledge. I want to keep the class together. This is the next thing they need to know, right? Everyone stop, regardless of where you're up to. Let me teach you the next thing. And of course, by default, most of them aren't listening to you because they're not ready for it anyway. And plus, they haven't made the choice. They haven't made the choice to learn the next thing. And so by flipping that around, by giving them some work where they can be actively involved and more, more self-directed, and then they hit the roadblocks. Just the fact that say, can you show me this next thing? It doesn't sound much, but it's a very different way to teach. People who are watching this who haven't done course, they're going to go, well, what's a fractional doing? So I actually stole, I, st I, well, stole, I did steal the idea. I got her permission. I can't remember who. Do you remember who wrote the Enrich-O-Matic series? It's an amazing little problem-solving series of books by,
No.
I can't remember. Anyway, Enrich-E-Matic's, fantastic little series. Anyway, she had a little fraction, a couple of fraction worksheets in there where instead of finding the answer, you were finding the number that was in the question. So a half of what number is 12, right? That's a simple one. And I thought, that's genius, but it should be all mixed up because we should be teaching fractions, decimals, percentages together. So that's where the idea came from. And so I spent a lot of time years ago putting the stuff together sequentially. And so did you, and it's really powerful for kids. Now, and I want to talk about this because it points to a misconception that a lot of teachers have. So a lot of teachers using a sheet like that will think, well, I can't use this with my kids unless they know how to answer it, because there's no routine. There's no routine to follow. That's why sheets like this are so good, or resources, because there's no routine they can follow. Therefore, they have to draw on their understanding. Oh, well, Richard, we can't use that because most of my kids don't have those concepts. No. That's why you use it, but you've got to have the pedagogy to back it up. So you have your 5 sets of answer sheets up the front or whatever you do. So it's when they do what they can, come out, mark it, and then they come to you and go, I don't know how these work. And that's when you're saying, you don't give them the answer, you ask other questions related to that question. And how many times, like, let's say it is, how some number of quarters of 12 is 8, right? So the answer is obviously 3. And they go, I don't know how this works. So the obvious question is, well, what would 1 quarter be? Oh,
Yep,
3.
correct.
Oh, and immediately they jump it. They've got the answer. And so that's strengthening their conceptual understanding rather than some routine, because there's not a routine. And then you're drawing diagrams, and before you finish drawing the diagram, they've got it, haven't they?
And the thing that reminded me too, we had an instructional leader working with us this year, and one of the first things that he pushed through was the Singapore bar charts. So that descent method slotted in very well with which was something that we're pushing out for all of our Year 8 teachers to incorporate in their understanding. But yeah, on that roadblocking, I mean, if you think of a question like a third plus a half, if I was to ask teachers how to draw that, I'm sure they might sort of, that could be a bit out of their comfort zone. So if I've got kids that, that would just be their roadblock, what's a third plus a half? Can you draw it? Split it up.
And so by roadblocking, you're saying designing activities where kids will hit the brick wall and then seek help either with their friends or with you or something. And so they are, rather than copying down some procedure and just cranking out the numbers, they're actually thinking about what's going on.
Yeah, and I think like when you and I or other maths teachers think of concepts, we have an image in our minds of what it looks like. But sometimes we're not very good at sharing that with 28 kids in the room. I know as an early career teacher, I teach things like the cross method, which has no conceptual understanding. Why does that even work? And later on you can think if you have a half and you split it into each half into thirds, then that is fundamentally how the cross method works. But yeah, providing the kids with the room and the space, they can spend a whole period answering one question and that's good. It's there's no pressure to get through a whole buttload of content
So,
or worksheet.
just thinking about this, I mean, when you talk about, well, what does even working conceptually mean? Oh, so it means a whole lot of equipment in the room, or I can't do that. No, well, it doesn't necessarily mean a whole lot of equipment. It just means, and here I reckon is the key. If they're working through a worksheet and there's no procedure that they can follow to get the answer, then you're on the track to having something that's conceptually based. Because if there's no procedure, it's not to say, look, I used to talk about this years ago, and people would go, oh, so you're saying, Richard, that we shouldn't teach procedures. And I'm going, no, I've never said that. But essentially, if you're talking conceptually, oh, he doesn't like procedures, he doesn't believe in procedures. No, you do both, but the understanding's got to come first, I think.
Yeah, and kids like, I mean, I had Pythagoras this year, and I teach Pythagoras as a as an area topic. It's not a it's nothing more than that. It's drawing squares, and then for the kids in my class, they discover that, what pattern can you see with the numbers? What shortcuts can you think? And then suddenly they develop it themselves, and the procedure comes from them. But to me, procedural-based teaching, I think, is what causes a lot of people to, ask that question. Where am I going to use this in the real world? And the truth is, you'll never use a random procedure which you have no understanding of in the real world. But we come up with all these suggestions about, where they may, but that's not what they're listening. They're just seeing a random series of steps to a number that they seek validation from us. And again, that learned helplessness.
Are you starting to see kids working more conceptually and are just enjoying the process of the collaboration and getting their hands dirty with the concepts? And that's what you're saying. Therefore, they're not going to say, oh, where will it ever need this? Because there's an enjoyment factor in that learning process.
Absolutely. In fact, I've said all my classes the last number of years, the second that a student says, where am I ever going to use this? I'll challenge them and say, I bet you I know the thought just before you said that. And the thought before that was, I'm not enjoying this or I hate this. And the thought before that was, I'm stuck and I don't know what to do. So they don't get from, trying to solve a problem to thinking, where am I actually going to use this pragmatically? It comes from a place of, they're unhappy. And then if you try and, list off your uses as engineering and plumbing, all they're going to hear is, well, I can't do that.
I'm laughing because I used to get hit with this question all the time. And what would frustrate me is that I would start answering the question that they asked, and their eyes glaze over. And I'm thinking they're never interested in my answer. And then the most obvious dawned on me, and the most obvious is that's not the question they're asking. They're not saying, Mr. Andrew, when will we ever use this? They're saying, Mr. Andrew, can I get out the door? Can I leave your boring lesson? Can I get out of here? Can I not have to do m That's the question they're asking, right? So then I would, because I had a really good rapport with them. So when they'd ask that question, they'd go, oh, Peter, you're not asking that question. You just want to get out the door, don't you? And it goes, yep. I go, that's what I thought. So I'm not going to answer it. And I'll move on.
And for the biggest
But,
mistake you can make is,
I, sorry, go on.
I was going to say the biggest mistake you could make in that situation would be then to rattle off all the very important things that you need that particular skill for, because all they're hearing is,
Blah,
well,
blah,
I
blah.
can't do any of those things. Right? I can't be an electrician. I can't do that.
Yeah. There's a lot of push to say, look, we need to make maths relevant. And I agree with that. And I agree with that. But I think that's not quite the full picture. Because some, like, it's very difficult to make surge relevant, right? And the answer, I think, is in working this way. Because if you've got kids who are working with the concepts and working with their mates and collaborating, and the activities are engaging, and they're using their own brain rather than something that we've taught them, and then they lead to the procedures, and then they're remembering stuff, etc., etc. That is fun, whether they can see the relevance or not, and that's engaging because they're involved in the actual process. There's agency in what they're doing, and I think that's the mantra we should be, Yes, try and make it relevant if you can. But I imagine there's a lot of teachers who spend a lot of time trying to make maths relevant, and it still not doesn't quite tick the box for students. They're going,
Yeah, I
oh,
think relevance.
sorry.
Yeah, I get it. My opinion on that would be the relevance has to be, does it link to something they already understand? And I think a lot of what we do from 7 to 10 or even into 11 and 12 just comes down to how to group, how to partition. So it's down to timesing and dividing. And it took me a lot. In fact, probably 2 years ago, I remember this memory where I'd been confusing kids with division because it means two different things. So if I say 10 divided by 2, does that mean I'm splitting 10 into two groups? And the answer is the size of each group, or am I pairing them off into twos? Like how many twos fit the 10? Conceptually, they're two very different things. And it's a result of when you multiply numbers in different orders. So three groups of five is different to five groups of three, but you end up with the same result. So sometimes we interchangeably talk about division, where sometimes we're splitting or grouping, but in our heads, we're not communicating that. So when we're talking about, the content that we're trying to teach, if we link it to those basic skills in a way that makes sense to them, then the relevance won't be lost. If we're talking about area, it really starts with arrays. There's no point talking about triangles or trapeziums if they don't understand how an array works.
So is there anything like, well, how long have you been teaching?
10 years.
Yeah, right. So at that point, like, I was really exploring these ideas because I've said this before, I was literally driven. My first year of teaching, I walked out of a room thinking, I've got no idea how to do this. This is crazy. I'm boring the pants off these kids. And it drove me nuts. And so I thought, there's got to be a way in which you can present the stuff that fires the kids up. And then, it's exciting when you come across something, an idea, which you don't necessarily know it's going to work, but it's on the right path to a decent approach. I'm putting it on the spot here because we haven't talked about this, but do you have any recent, or not so recent, like, wow, I'm going to have give this a crack, and then you've kind of tweaked it over the years?
All the time. I say every single year, like I'm a better teacher now than I am last year. I'm not as good now, I'm sure, as a year from now. So there's always that room to grow. I've had a lot of good mentors over the years, in different subject areas. So I sort of pick and choose, and a lot of what I've done, I've got a bit of experience with like student well-being, and it's really just trying to connect with kids, so they know that you care about their learning.
So why are you like that? Because not everyone is, are
Yeah, I'm aware of that. No, you're right.
they?
And
And
when you hear sentences like,
it mystifies me that's not more common in teachers, because if teachers got to be the worst gig if you're not really loving it, and I don't think you can really love it unless you're growing and learning and finding better ways to engage your kids.
I agree 100%. I remember saying that at my job interview, it was, I'm not the best teacher I can be, which might sound like a strange thing to say at an interview, but then I followed up with, I think you've made a fundamental mistake in education if you think you've reached the pinnacle, because what we're doing is about learning, not teaching. The focus isn't us, it's the kids that are changing.
So look, we'll wrap this up, but if you get a first year out teacher under your wing, what's the number one message do you think that you would hope that that teacher feels that Jeff instilled in me in my first year?
Right. I don't know.
Throwing you in the
I'd
deep
probably
end.
say, yeah, that's fine. I'd probably just say, like, really going with a plan for what you want the kids to achieve for each lesson. And again, it's not about what am I teaching this lesson. It's, I know that little Talia in the corner doesn't understand how to count up by threes. So let's find perimeter questions that might give her the opportunity to develop that skill. It's each lesson thinking, what is it I want them to walk away with? And you're just building on one idea further and further and further. Chuck out the syllabus, not entirely, but you can, yep. So you've got those content statements. Think about what is the main skill that you're developing in the kids. And if you want to, improve their skill of multiplication, you've got opportunities to do that through area, through financial maths, petitioning, through percentages and GST. We're really repeating the same ideas over and over again, but to really try and, walk in and then, build on those.
That chuck out the syllabus thing, when you think about it, like, I think we get, I mean, how many thousands of hours, man hours, woman hours, are spent on these new syllabuses, right? And I think we spend so much nervous energy on trying to get all that right and trying to teach it. But if the kids are not engaged first, then we might as well just turn to the wall and talk. I mean, that's the thing that's always mystified me in education. And I've been nomadic. I've been in Northern Territory, South Australia, whatever. I've done a lot of casual teaching. So I've been in about 300 different classrooms in my different stints. And I've also had permanent stints. Man, it's interesting. And I'm thinking, how can any kid learn if they're not engaged? And yet engagement's this hard thing we can't really put a number on it, so we sort of don't talk about it. It's
But
just so.
furthermore, I mean, you have teachers of year seven students that will refer to the HSC, but you have to cover all of these points because in HSC they've got to do this, and it's like the HSC is a broken system. And they can acknowledge that the HSC is a crap system. So then why do we proceed to then break every other thing we do to fit the broken end goal?
Because it's
How
what the
about
university said.
7 through 10, we just do it right. And then for those that, can do the ATAR, the HSC course, yep, let's have a crack at a very different way of approaching content.
So the point I was trying to make with it, you mentioned it, not me, I wouldn't say, but you said throw out the syllabus. Like, if you've got a class that's really struggling, okay, we can bang on about the syllabus, but what are they going to learn? They're going to still be disengaged. They're probably going to hate maths even more than they did when we started, and they're not going to learn anything. So if we can say, okay, let's see if we can get these kids fired up, learning together, understanding a few things, and progressing in their mathematical knowledge, and enjoying playing with maths in a constructive way that's well, that is well structured. It's not just like, let's see what you can do with this equipment. That's got to be a really good thing. But it might not be quite bang on the, you might only cover a smaller percentage of the dot points, but at least you're doing something that is valid. I don't know. That's, to me, it's a no-brainer, but I could get lynched for saying that.
Oh, look, I think So if you ask a lot of high school teachers, what do you teach? They'll often say the subject area. Whereas, if you ask primary teachers, they'll just say, I teach kids, students. I think that if we take that same approach.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Hey, Jeff, that's been awesome. Thanks so much. We should do this again sometime. And I love the fact that you're exploring your own pedagogy and the way you're thinking. I think your teachers are obviously lucky that they've got someone like that at the top, because it just makes being a maths teacher so much more valid and useful. So good on you. So thanks for that, and we'll maybe chat another time. Cheers.
Yep, thank you for the course. Good.